Welcome to the Orange Couch.
I'm Mark.
I'm Amanda.
And this is Mad Men, Season 6, Episode 8.
The Craft.
All of them. All in it together. All of them. Older than witches. Don't you worry, little Andy or Jenny. I'll kill them before I let them touch you.
Of course, Sally Draper is reading Rosemary's Baby, which is the classic 60s horror tale of paranoia and horror within the nuclear family. Rosemary discovers that her kindly neighbors and her loving husband are actually evil, Satan-worshipping witches who set her up to be raped by Satan. And that much-wanted pregnancy is actually gestating the Antichrist. Nothing that bad happens to anyone in this episode, but the general sense of unease and horror comes in no small part from people being something other than what they appear to be, or in some cases, what Don wants them to be.
Don's extended drug-induced fugue state feels suspended from time, and so does the flashback to his feverish seclusion in the room of a prostitute. Both of them jolt him back to the real world with a thonk to the head, too, one from a wooden spoon, and the other when he hits the floor. But while Dick is holed up with Amy, he starts to project onto her the role of the mother he wishes he had. She dotes on him with what was apparently the most inspiring soup in human history. She takes his comfort seriously, and she generally treats him like a person. But she's no mother. She's just a mischief maker who may be a pedophile, and she's only using Dick for fun. If she actually cared a lick for him, she'd never have sold him out at the end.
Of course, the most jolting character in the episode is the woman who calls herself Grandma Ida. On one level, it's easy to read this character as a gross racial stereotype. The second time I watched it, however, what struck me was that she was using the racist stereotype of the loving mammy to confuse the white kids long enough to steal a bunch of the Draper stuff. Of course, they have no idea that Don wouldn't have enough money to have a nanny when he was a kid, like their mother did. This, as with most things these days, is Don's fault.
I asked her everything I know, and she had an answer for everything. Then I realized I don't know anything about you.
The other person who appears out of nowhere is Wendy, the I Ching girl. We're initially led to believe Wendy's just an unattached hippie type, like Lakshmi from last season. Putting Harry in the background of that scene was no coincidence. Wendy tells everyone, and especially Don, that she's there to make them feel better. And she hits on every older man until one of them sleeps with her while another watches. Then we learn what a sociopath Jim Cutler really is.
How could you bring Frank's little girl here?
I let her tag along. I kept an eye on her, didn't I, Don?
Wendy is no free spirit, or at least that's not all she is. She's a person who just lost her father to cancer, and the extent to which she pursues validation from men his age is far more troubling than we had thought.
Sylvia and Peggy have no intention of misrepresenting themselves in the slightest, but because Don has all these fantasies about what women are supposed to be, he ends up resenting them for being something different. He rushes around during a speed freakout, convinced that he can somehow walk Sylvia into seeing herself as the devoted mommy figure to him he wants her to be. And then he sobers up and realizes that actually, she has other more pressing concerns, which he hates her for. We also see in this episode how much he's coming to resent Peggy because Peggy isn't willing to play the adoring protege for him anymore. On the contrary, she's found a new man to look up to, Teddy, who actually pays her the respect she deserves, which Don was always incapable of doing.
During the first wave of drugs from ass to brain, Don even thinks Ted's secretary might be his long-lost prostitute fake mother for a second. Anyone with strong eyebrows is never entirely safe from Don.
The other theme of Rosemary's Baby that the writers of Mad Men borrowed is the sense of loss of faith and family and growing instability in the 60s that the book and the movie really captured. The right wing likes to blame feminism for this, but Mad Men and Rosemary's Baby both avoid such easy scapegoating, and even go so far as to suggest that the male abuse of women is a much bigger problem than women demanding their rights. Either way, just as Rosemary loses her husband and baby to the forces of evil, this episode was obsessed with people losing their family members and sometimes finding poor substitutes for their loved ones, like Rosemary finding a demon in her baby's cradle.
Since we're talking about Rosemary's Baby, let's talk about the two missing babies from this episode. The first is Amy's. Dick glimpses the photo in the mirror and asks if it's her. It's not, and the moment around her answer implies something much sadder. Maybe her child died, or maybe she gave it up for adoption. like a certain other person, Peggy. She doesn't say it directly, but we know what Peggy means when she talks of loss. I don't think Peggy regrets her choice, but that doesn't mean she pretends it came with no cost.
There were tons of missing people mentioned in this episode. Frank Gleason, father of Wendy and friend to Ted. Stan loses his cousin. Don's missing mother hangs over his head. Don himself is an absentee father. The substitutes people look for are never good enough either. Don's stepmother is abusive. Sally can't play an adult caretaker as well as Megan hopes. And, of course, you have a woman claiming to be Don's mother who actually just robs him blind. The only real mother in this entire episode is Betty. And when she steps into the room and takes her children back, things go back to normal.
Part of normalcy is acknowledging the truth, and returning to Peggy's scene, she offers this advice to Stan.
I've had loss in my life. You have to let yourself feel it.
That's the opposite of Don's advice to her after giving birth, to pretend it never happened. It's also the same advice he gave to Sylvia about their affair early on, too. Peggy's clearly learned that Don is miserable because of the way he lies to himself. But at the same time, this episode gave us a glimpse into why Don/Dick has become such a good liar. Because as a young man, he wasn't. His face betrayed him, and that got him his ass kicked, but good. Now we know a bit more about why Don spent decades crafting such an inscrutable exterior.
What lies will Don be telling others and himself next week?
We'll find out on Speedballs to the Ass, I mean, The Orange Couch.